Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Let's stand and sing our opening praise this morning.
And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Face today, and in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away.
Everybody's palm frond up and say with me, Hosanna.
Hosanna!
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. You may be seated for just a moment. Come on. I give praise that you chose to come here to worship with us on this Palm Sunday. It is a wonderful kickoff to Holy Week as we sing our Hosannas. But also, we have Holy Week programs. It begins on Thursday. Thursday, we are having our Maundy Thursday service. It's a communion, scripture-filled time where we get to gather at tables of 12. It's a glorious experience. I encourage you to put it on your calendar to attend. Also, on Good Friday, something we've never done before. It's a dramatic telling of the Good Friday story. So 7 o'clock on Friday. Now, next Sunday is
Easter.
Of course it's Easter. And this is an opportunity for you to invite a friend or a neighbor. And just to help you with that, when you leave today, we'll have some invitation cards. They're beautifully done, and you can just hand them to them and say, hey, just wanted to invite you to our church. Or you could stick it in their door, you could put it in their mailbox, you could plaster their car. Is this being streamed? Well, in all of this, we are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Well, let us stand and turn to our neighbors and give a hearty Hosanna.
All right, hearty, hearty. That's hearty. Alrighty, let's gather back. Now we're going to have a special blessing of our palms. So if you would just hold your palms in your hands. Dear friends in Christ, during Lent, we have been preparing for the celebration of our Lord's Easter mystery. On this day, our Lord Jesus Christ entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph. People welcomed him with palms, shouts of praise, but the path before him led to self-giving, suffering, and death. And today, we greet Jesus as our King, although we know that his crown is thorns and his throne a cross. We follow him this week from the glory of the palms to the glory of the resurrection by the way of the dark road of suffering and death, knowing that as we are united with him in his suffering on the cross, we also shall share in him in the glory of his resurrection. And now let's pray together this prayer of blessing. Bless these palms in the hands that hold them, that our lives may honor you with resounding praise and heartfelt dedication. May these be a symbol of our... Okay, yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
exalted. The King is exalted on high. Let us confess with our mouths what it is that you believe before Lord God Almighty. I believe, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day, he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And from thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Okay, if I can have the children come forward for children's chat. Where are you? All that's it. Come on up. Come on up. All right. Oh, get your palms. You got your palms? Got to bring your palms. Everybody bring your palms. Don't forget your palms. All right. Yeah, this is palms are your best friend today. All right. Awesome. Yeah, let's all keep standing. Let's all look out that way. All right. Perfect. Hey, good. Come on up. Come on up. Well, today is Palm Sunday. Has any one of you ever been to a parade? All right. Tell me what kind of a parade it was. Do you remember? What kind of parade?
Christmas.
Say?
Christmas.
A Christmas parade. What about another parade? Anybody been to another? Yes.
4th of July.
4th of July. Absolutely. Another one?
Thanksgiving.
Thanksgiving parade. All right. Awesome. Well, what happens at a parade? Can somebody tell me what happens at a parade? All right. Tell me. Yeah.
They give you candy.
Oh, they give you candy. Yes. Well, that's going to happen in our parade today, so we're good with that. So I wanted just to talk to you about Palm Sunday is when Jesus went into the city of Jerusalem. And Jerusalem was like the capital city. And there was a big church there. It was called the temple. And when he was coming up, people raised their palms like this. Raise them up. And they said, Hosanna in the highest. Let's everybody do that for them. Ready? Hosanna in the highest. And you notice how people are just so excited about, they were seeing Jesus. And so Jesus had a special love, and one of his special love was for children. And so we're told in the scriptures that it wasn't just adults there, it was children who were praising Jesus and praying and praising him. And the word Hosanna means save us, Lord. Pardon? There's spiky parts of this too. Yeah, absolutely. All right. So today on Palm Sunday, I want you to remember that Palm Sunday is like a parade for Jesus, and it's a time for us to share our love for him and our love for each other. The choir did that. All right. Awesome. Awesome. All right. Let's bow our heads. Let's have a prayer. Dear God, thank you for your love and your care. Bless my family. Bless my friends. Bless my church. I love you, Jesus, with all my heart. Keep me ever in your care. Amen. Okay, so you said at a parade you get candy. Well, at church you get treats from Pastor John. All right, let's go find them. There they are. I got more fruit by the foot over here if you want.
Fruit by the foot.
Hey, guys.
Do you have double stuffed Oreos?
All right.
I can't get someone for my brother.
You can. You can get someone for your brother. You can get someone for anybody. There you go. Okay, that's what I learned from putting a variety in there. All right. Very good. You got 80 brothers? That's good. Do you want to get some? Did you get some? All right. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Come back on Easter Sunday. We got a special for Easter Sunday you're going to get. All right. Awesome. All right. Thank you. Thank you.
Let us join our hearts in prayer this morning. Oh, gracious and loving God, on this new and beautiful morning, we bow down and joyously shout, Hosanna, because you are the King of Kings and you are worthy of our praise. Unto you, Lord, we bestow our bodies, our souls, our spirits, that we may be transformed into the likeness of our precious Savior, Jesus. Everlasting Father, as we begin Holy Week, oh Lord, we would ask that you draw us deeper into our relationship with you, that we will better understand Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. May your Spirit reach into our hearts and reveal the depth, the true depth of your love for us that causes us to love you more and long for your companionship over that of the world. Oh Lord, may our love for you grow so deep that we see the world around us through your eyes, that we see all those you have created, Lord, who do not know you, and we extend your love. Oh Prince of Peace, we confess that we have fallen short. Forgive us, we pray. Help us comprehend how you long for the reconciliation of all of humanity and of creation itself. We look forward to the day when everything you have created will be made new. In the meantime, though, help us love as you love. Help us to extend grace as you extend grace. Help us to be living hands and feet to the world around us today, tomorrow, and Lord, as long as we have breath and life. This morning, O Lord, we lift our mission team in the Dominican Republic. We pray that they have every provision they need. We pray for their safety, and we pray for the powerful witness of the love of this church to a people in great need. O Lord, bless them. Bless them, we pray. Help this team speak Jesus in everything they say and do, and bring them home safely to us, we pray. And now in the silence, Lord, we lift up anyone we know who is in need this morning. Whatever their concern or issue may be, we lift them to you now. We pray your blessing on them. We pray your healing on them. Let them feel your eternal presence and strength. And we say thank you, Lord. Thank you for what is already accomplished in your holy name. Oh Lord, as Pastor John comes to speak your word, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, do a new work in us, put a new song in our hearts, prepare us to be an Easter people who have felt the deep sorrow of our sin nailed to that cross, forgiven and resurrected with our Savior Jesus Christ. Let us boldly proclaim that you are our Savior and our Lord. And we ask this in the precious name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. My friends, as we call the ushers this morning, let us receive this blessing over the offering. Oh Lord, what we are about to give was yours before it was ours. And now, Lord, we ask your blessing upon it as we faithfully give back to the work of your kingdom. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Mm-hmm.
see the King of glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see His love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people sing, the people sing. To take their place with selfless faith, with selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and see. We're on our knees, we're on our knees.
Today is from Matthew 21, 1 through 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mountain of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from the the Nazareth in Galilee. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
The great crowd that had gathered heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." The crowd praised him, celebrated his miracles, and with great expectation, told everyone about him. But they did not know him. They were waiting for someone who would rule with strength and might, but he came as a humble servant. They were expecting a general who would crush their enemies, but he came saying, "Love your enemies." They wanted him to finally bring their people glory, but he wanted to change them so their lives would bring God glory. They would soon realize that Jesus wasn't gonna be what they wanted, and they turned on him before they ever realized he was what they needed. And as they yelled, "Crucify!" Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you a king?" Jesus answered, "I am not that kind of king. His kingdom isn't what you see here. It won't be established by chaos and war. His kingdom is in our hearts. His kingdom is righteousness, forgiveness, and love. Today, we lift our voices. We cry, Hosanna, Lord, save us. Come dwell in our hearts, Jesus Christ, our King."
Well, welcome again to worship. And if you're with us online, we greet you this Palm Sunday. We are so honored to have you with us. You know, Palm Sunday is just such a special Sunday. I know growing up, we probably all have different memories of Palm Sunday if you're different faith traditions. You know, I couldn't help but remember this morning a Palm Sunday when I was just a brand new young pastor. And at that time, my kids were about 5 and 6. And I'll never forget, my son woke up on Palm Sunday and he had a raging sore throat, so he couldn't come to church. And we went to church and we had palms and we were raising palms. And so she walks in the house with her palm and she's waving her palm and she's waving it at her little brother, irritating him. And he goes, "What's that?" And she said, "Well, the people waved these at Jesus as he was walking through the crowd." And my son just looked at me and said, "Wouldn't you know, one Sunday I miss and Jesus shows up." I'll never forget that Palm Sunday. Before we begin today's message, I just wanted to ask you a question. And that question is this. Are you a fan of Jesus Christ? Or are you a follower of Jesus Christ? Let's keep that in our minds as we go through our worship. You know, some years ago, a book was written by a noted American historian, When the Cheering Stopped. And it was about President Woodrow Wilson in World War I. It was the events that were leading up to it and leading after it. And so President Wilson was this international hero at the end of the war. People thought there would never be any more wars because Wilson was such an advocate for world peace and for democracy. And not only did this catch in the United States, but abroad, internationally, in Italy and France and in Austria and Vienna. And on his visit to Paris, we're told that he was greeted by cheering mobs, mobs that were bigger than mobs in the United States. In Vienna, it was near Christmas time. And we're told that the poor state of that country, they didn't have gifts for the children. And so they had to tell, Red Cross had to tell the children. And the children even said to their workers, they said, no. President Wilson will see that we give these, that we get gifts. And so that cheering and shouting lasted about a year. And then it gradually began to stop. It turned out that after the war was over, the political leaders in Europe were now not concerned so much about world peace, but were concerned about their own agendas than a lasting peace. And then we're told that President Wilson ran into opposition in the United States Senate, and the League of Nations that he worked on, he wanted ratified, was not approved. And then we're also told that under the strain of all this that was brewing, President Wilson had a stroke. And not only did that happen, but then in that election, his party lost the election. So it was that Woodrow Wilson, a man who barely 1 year ago was heralded as the New World's Messiah, came to the end of his days, a broken and defeated man. It's a story that we see all that often. Someone rising to power and then all of a sudden things turn. Made me start to think about the events of Palm Sunday. You know, it happened to Jesus that way. When he emerged on the public scene, he was like this overnight sensation, this success. People came from far and near. They wanted to hear him preach. They wanted to hear him teach. And we're told that people were just so excited to be in his presence. But then as time went on, the crowds got smaller and smaller. And we're told that people who were afraid to speak up because the crowd was so loud for him, all of a sudden when they saw things getting smaller, they started to speak up. And they started to interject their own agendas. And then we're told that as this was happening, that you know, the folks in that day were just, you know, started then to try to discredit his moral character. And they couldn't do that. So if we can't discredit your moral character, let's see what else we can discredit. Maybe your political or your theological. And so what happens to Jesus then is the people start to publicly attack him, and this thing snowballs and snowballs, and ends up with Jesus under the weight of a cross. Now, why did the cheering stop? Why did the cheering stop? What changed that crowd into being followers of Jesus Christ to just being fans? Well, today I want to talk with you about that because I have three things that I think were going on. And I think we can learn from this and this Palm Sunday, refresh our commitment to the cause of Jesus Christ in our life and in this world. So the first reason is this. I believe that the cheering stopped when Jesus started to talk more and more about commitment. You know, during the last week of his life, we have this encounter that happens with Jesus and a rich young ruler. And this encounter is in front of everybody, so everybody's seeing this. And we're told that this rich young ruler goes to Jesus and says, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus says, "Go, sell all that you have, and come and follow me." Now the people that heard that were witnessing that, they thought, "I got him." You see, because in those days, if you had wealth, you were a blessed person. You had the favor of God. So people that day were looking at Jesus and saying, "Why would you demand the favor of God to be given away to follow you?" The second thing that I noticed in that time when Jesus was calling people to more and more commitment was, if you read in the scriptures, in those last so many days, you know, there were no more miracles. I mean, we read about Jesus performing miracles, turning water into wine, feeding the 5,000. And now in this season of life, Jesus is now not performing miracles, but he's talking about God's grace. And not only God's grace, but Jesus began to talk about the obligation that rests with the person who's accepted God's grace. I'm sure that the people of the day didn't like that word, obligation. An obligation that rests with us when we experience and accept God's grace. Jesus Jesus is saying, the time for miracles is now over. The time for commitment is now. And you know, it's really interesting that in the Bible, in all the Gospels, we hear this Palm Sunday story, but most of the Gospels are related to the last 7 days of Jesus' life. And if you read them, you understand the significance of this. And so I think as we figure what changed in that crowd, well, the first thing was Jesus began to talk more and more about commitment. The second thing that occurred to me this week was this. Why did the cheering stop? Well, Jesus dared to suggest that all people are worth loving. So let's look what happened on Palm Sunday. You know, we told Jesus comes through the temple, he goes through Jerusalem, and then he goes to the temple. And when he gets to the temple, he finds people gambling and money changers. And what does he do? He overturns the tables and he casts those people out. People who probably felt, I deserve to be here. And what does he do? He invites in the poor, the lame, the outcast, those people that are on the fringe of society. And oh, people didn't like that. By bringing these people in, what Jesus was saying, and he's saying to us all today, that all people have access to God. All people. You know, and I think that as this was happening, we understand that Jesus then was trying to get people to understand that we're all God's children and we're supposed to love everyone. You know, it's interesting in that Palm Sunday story, when Jesus is coming through Jerusalem, he encounters a man who's crippled and he's one of those outcasts, and he's raising up Jesus. He says, Son of David, have mercy on me. And what did the people do? They told him, shut up. Oh, and then in the story, we also hear the ones that were actually hail Jesus as the Messiah and Lord were not the religious leaders of that day. It were the children. And we're told that the children were lining the streets and the children were waving their palm branches. And what did the scripture say? What were they told? Be quiet. You see, in that day, people were saying one thing and acting differently. And I think it was interesting that all the religious leaders and the political leaders of that day didn't see Jesus for who he really was. And look who did. Those children, the lame, the poor. They recognized Jesus as the Messiah. And the ones, the people that had power, resisted it. For a fleeting moment, the children showed us what the kingdom of God is like. So why did the children stop? Well, Jesus opened the doors of the church to everyone. People wrestled with it then. We wrestle with it now. So many issues can divide us. So many issues can close our doors, but all are welcome. And as I said last week, we keep a biblical lens on. We honor our biblical traditions, our beliefs, but we don't deny anyone into our church family, into God's kingdom. Doesn't Romans say all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God? Notice how it didn't say just some people were sinned. It says all. Now, the third one, and probably more significant, is that Jesus began to talk more and more about a cross. You see, when Jesus emerged on the scene in his public ministry, he talked about the kingdom of God, and people were excited because they thought he was going to rebuild the kingdom of David, the kingdom of Israel, and they were thinking of worldly things, and I can just imagine in their mind, they were thinking of riches and gold and buildings, and how glorious it's going to be. And they went on that tangent, but now Jesus is starting to talk about the kingdom of God, and the kingdom of God being something that we have to commit to, that we have to love others, but also that we have to take on obligation, oh, and sacrifice. That the kingdom of God might mean we have to sacrifice. Got to tell you this little story while I'm talking about sacrifice and how we handle sacrifice. That Palm Sunday that my son, that happened with him, all of a sudden around 12 o'clock noon, he was miraculously better. Have it happen with your kids, like all of a sudden, because we were going to have a baseball game, okay? Dad, I'm feeling great. Well, I'm going to tell you, we had this baseball game, and it was, our church had a little peewee league, and the Lutheran church down the street had a peewee league, and so it was the Methodists against the Lutherans. And I remember, I've always told him, I said, as your coach, if I give you the sign, I want you to do a sacrifice bunt, okay? If I give you the sign. So, we're there. I give him the sign. I'm like, and what he does, whoosh, out. Whoosh, no, whoosh, strikes out. We lost the game. After the game, I went up to him and I said, Robert, I gave you the sign. He goes, yeah, I know, Dad. I saw you gave me the sign, but I didn't think you meant it. But folks, isn't that sometimes what we do to Jesus, to God? He gives us these signs. He calls us to commitment. He calls us to love. He calls us to the cross. And don't we sometimes go our own way and go, Jesus, I don't think you meant it. Why did the cheering stop? I believe the cheering stopped because Jesus began more and more to talk about commitment. Because Jesus opened the doors of the church to everyone. And that Jesus began to talk more and more about a cross. So as we return to Palm Sunday, I ask you that question. Are you a fan of Jesus? Or are you a follower? The reason why we did give palms and I bless these palms, because we have a tradition that we take the, I want you to take these home. I want you to place them somewhere where you spend the most time with your family. For me, it's our kitchen table because we love to eat, okay? But I want you to keep this there, and I want you to look at it every day this week as we go through Holy Week. And I wanted to remind you, and when you see it, think about it. Am I being a fan of Jesus Christ today, or am I being a follower? And what you'll notice is as the week goes on, this is going to kind of shrivel and wither. And I'd say, just leave it there. Because every time you see that, know that as things wither and fade in this world, being a follower of Jesus Christ has the promise of a kingdom that is beyond our imagination. So I have some next steps for you today, things that you can be praying and doing during this week. First one is this. Pray that the Holy Spirit strengthens your commitment to Jesus to show you how to improve your walk with Him. If you're really a follower, we should always be asking, what can I be doing better, Jesus? What can I be doing more to love you and love others as you call me? Second one is this. Pray for the church of Jesus Christ, that it's going to remain committed to biblical teaching, but will open its doors in Christ-like love to all God's people. And the third one is this. Take time this week, especially, to follow the way of the cross. We have Maundy Thursday service. If you come, you're going to be able to sit at table. You're going to be able to experience communion as our disciples did at the Last Supper. And then on Good Friday, we have a first time we've ever done a service like this. But you're going to have an opportunity to sit at the foot of the cross and be with Jesus and hear the events of what happened on that Good Friday. And then as Pastor Bob said, invite someone to worship to experience the victory of Jesus Christ. Because someone desperately needs to hear that message this Easter. And are you going to be a fan, or are you just going to be a follower? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us to this time of worship, Lord. We thank you for the grandeur of music today and worship and singing your praise. And Father, we feel the presence of Jesus with us. But we know, Lord, the events of what happened 5 days later. So I pray, Lord, that as we go through this week, we would continue to seek you as we strive to develop our Christian leadership, our Christian commitment, and our Christian love. And God, I just pray that you would only continue to bless and keep us in your care. Jesus, we love you. We thank you for the cross, because you are worthy and you are seated on the throne. Whom now, Lord, we call upon you. Worthy is the Lamb. We're going to be singing a song, Worthy is the Lamb, and when I gesture to you, would you stand and sing with us?
In love you.
Just want to say thank you to our choir, our orchestra, our praise band, our praise team, to Cheryl and to Carol for this glorious music today. Come back for Easter Sunday because it's going to be even more glorious. And now let's join together and let's pray our benediction as we go forth on this Palm Sunday. Jesus, as we go forth this Palm Sunday, we lift up this prayer in reverence of your boundless magnificence and love. Thank you for the wondrous reminder of your triumphant entry into Jerusalem and immeasurable sacrifice you made for us on the cross. May we remain committed to your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Bless and keep us until we meet again. And now, go forth in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And all God's people shall say the word. Amen.
'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away.